I'm Katori Hall, and this is The Breakdown. I think a lot of people don't realize that Southern strip club culture is very common and kind of part of your coming of age experience. And so I would go into those spaces and hang out with friends and see some of the most enthralling acrobatic feats I have ever seen in my life. And, you know, it would be these women up on stage flying around like birds. They would be up on these poles. And I was just like, oh my God, I'm seeing super sheroes. I learned for myself that what they do is a craft. It is Cirque du Soleil. It is just strength and flexibility on steroids. And I really felt like I want to make sure that people understand how hard this work is, this pole dancing. You know, in that first episode, you have Mercedes climbing up to the top of the pole, two stories high, right? And you see her flip herself upside down. And then, boom, all of a sudden the sound is gone. And you just hear her breathing. And that, I think, you know, drives the point home. This is hard work. I'm falling. I started interviewing a lot of women, just really learning about why they chose that profession. And I think what I learned is that sometimes that profession would choose them. A lot of people don't have a lot of choices. And so it ended up being a way to survive. These women that I met going into these clubs, you know, they really let me in inside their hearts, inside their homes. And I really, for myself, was able to witness their humanity. And I felt like it was just so important to do that for the world, because I know that they have been stigmatized, they've been dehumanized historically. And this show, particularly, you know, when I was starting that research, was just an attempt to humanize these women who I knew were these amazing, amazing athletes.
What's your name?
Autumn Knight.
Everyone knows that music is so important to strip club culture. Just looking at that world and understanding, like, so many careers have been made in that space, from Future to Migos, we really knew that the soundscape had to be just as important as the visual articulation of the show. I'm from Memphis, Tennessee, and the crunk, horrorcore trap sound is just something that I grew up on and something that vibrates and reverberates beyond the walls of the club. And I just really wanted to show my roots, my Black Southern roots, my ratchet roots, through the music.
That's my song. Song.
Jucee Froot, who is from my hometown of Memphis, I actually got on to her because my husband, he was flipping through Insta one day. He was like, do you know this girl Jucee Froot? Like, she's from Memphis. She got that, you know, that sound, real gutter, but very poetic as well. The twang and the style and the cultural specificity, I really felt like I needed her voice in our show. We actually reached out to her to do the main title. And I grew up playing this game, Down in the Valley, Hanky Panky. So it was like, Down in the Valley, Hanky Panky, Boo Fry, Jump from Bank to Bank. We said, ooh, ah, get a set, bit, that, pow. And so I was like, you know, Jucee, did you used to play that too? She was like, oh yeah, I know about it. And I always wanted to make sure that whatever our theme song was going to be, that it was going to be this earworm. And I know that Southern hand clap games, you know, you live with them forever. The fact that I'm almost 40 years old and I know Down in the Valley, Hanky Panky, you know, it's just tattooed on my tongue. And so when she went away and she came back with like the first draft of that theme song, it was, you know, an amazing jumping off point where we drilled down on the lyrics and we fused it with, you know, the honesty of how there's so many people still struggling down south. And these women, you know, when they're working in these clubs, like, it's a it's a very complicated space. It's exploitative, but empowering at the same time. And I think she landed on lyrics that really, really encapsulate both of those warring ideas.
Down in the valley where the girls get naked. If you throwing bands, then you know she gonna shake it. 1, 2, break 'em. 3, 4, break 'em.
As a Black content creator, there is this burden placed upon you, I think. And I don't think my white colleagues have to deal with it as much. Unfortunately, because Black folks have inherited just this huge box of stereotypical images, people are, they demand that, you know, you create Black people in the most perfect light. Like, how dare you put forth, you know, these Black women as strippers. And I say to that, like, you know, you are actually denying a group of people of their humanity if you're demanding that they be perfect all the time. I kind of decided that I'm not going to write or represent this world thinking of the white gaze, and I'm not going to think about the Black gaze either. I am just going to try and be as honest as I could possibly be about these women and their lives.
Once upon a time, I took a wrong turn.
I've been up and down this river looking for you.
So the interesting thing about trauma is that it actually never really goes away. It is that past that is always present. And we really wanted to make sure that people understood that oftentimes living in the past when you are in the present moment. And so, for example, I think when people go to the strip club, they're looking up on that stage and they're not understanding that they're looking at a flesh and blood human being. They think, oh, it's just an object of desire, but that object of desire has a past that, you know, sometimes intrudes on what is happening in the moment. And so in the first episode, for example, we have Autumn on the stage and all of a sudden the music kind of like drops away and we get these flashes of a very violent past. Of a man with a gun, of her fighting, of her being slapped down to the ground. And, you know, I've worked a lot with women who have suffered from domestic abuse in terms of some volunteer work I've done in the past. And this thing of being somewhere and all of a sudden a moment of violence intruding upon you and just changing the moment.
Life is just a long day's journey into tomorrow.
I always say that Chuckalisa is if Memphis and Jackson, Mississippi had a baby. It is, you know, a fictional town, but I really wanted to show the world a city country place, a place that is more about neighborhoods than skyscrapers, a place that is about community. Even, you know, within communities of struggle, there is family. And I thought it was so important to show that Mercedes had decided to keep herself planted in the hood. And so that scene in episode 2 where you see her, you know, running past places that are foreclosed and you know, saying hi to the guys as, you know, they've been on the corner for a little bit too long, but she knows them. It's a reflection of, you know, this is a Black person that has decided that, you know, while she aspires for more in her life, you know, she understands what it means to stay within her community and also to contribute to her community. I love the fact that I get to show off my Southern roots through the language, through the landscape. And even though it's so fictional, this town of Chuckalisa City, it does feel so real because it feels like a lot of Southern towns that I've rolled through where you see that line between the haves and the have-nots. You see that line between Black and white. And I think we've been able to articulate all of those themes through this fictional place of Chuckalisa City.
If it's one thing I know how to sell.
Mercedes!
It's the experience.
I don't think people see the bruises on Black women's bodies. We grow up knowing that people don't see our pain. And we know that Black women hurt. We know that Black women bleed. It's unfortunate that even today you can, you know, go into a hospital and a Black woman will be hurting, but she'll get less pain medicine than a white woman who's feeling even less pain than the Black woman. There's just this unfortunate idea that Black women are super women and that we don't need help and that we are all so strong. Miss Mississippi and in that moment just being with LaMurda, who clocks it and says, yes, Black women do bruise. It's an important way to show that, you know, we are so complex. We can have, we can be strong one minute and then the next minute, you know, we can dissolve into tears. This idea of Black women not being taken care of. The fact that Breonna Taylor's killers are still walking free. The Black female body. There's just so much denigration towards us. And so what I hope this show does for us and for those who don't have as much, people will see that they're just so human and they are deserving of protection because they are worthy, even though they are strippers.